many years. Gazing at Mount Tai, 闻岱宗夫如何，齐鲁青未了。 造化钟神秀，阴阳割昏晓。荡胸生层云，决眦入飞鸟。会当凌绝顶，一览众山小。Gazing
at Mount Tai, how to describe a peak that has produced such reverence. There's the greenness that surrounds two provinces, Qin and Luo. All creation is contained on those dark slopes, that sunny side. Layers of clouds refresh, climber and climbed alike. The birds fly up and up beyond our straining eyes. Someday, I want to stand right there on that summit, the other mountains dwarfed, spreading in all directions. The next poem, I will read an English translation first. It's called Gorgeous Women. See if you can, in your mind's eye, imagine the imagery that comes through this poem. Gorgeous women. Third day of the third month, a freshness in the air. On the banks of Cheng'an's winding river, many gorgeous women, regal bearing, distant manner, warm smiles for each other. Immaculate complexions, mostly perfect figures, dressed in embroidered silk, glittering in the sunlight, depicting golden peacocks and silver unicorns. What do they wear on their heads? Kingfisher ornaments, jade earrings. What do they wear on their backs? Close-fitting pearl-trimmed capes. Among them, the emperor's relatives, Lady Gua and Lady Jin. Now delicacies are served, purple camel hump steak in celadon cauldrons, white fish raw on crystal plates, but they are already sated. Their chopsticks sit unused. Elegant shredded morsels lie untouched. Attendants come cantering from the palace, stirring up no dust. The imperial kitchens keep sending out the rarest delicacies. There's music as well, drums and flutes, poignant enough to raise ghosts, and guests and retainers enough to prove the host's importance. And here he comes, quite slowly, riding along on horseback. He dismounts at the pavilion, walks on embroidered cushions. Willow catkins fall like snow, cover the white duckweed. A bluebird flies away, carrying a red napkin. Don't get too close to this prime minister. His vast power might scorch you. Don't want a man like that to turn on you in anger.
Okay, this poem was portrayed the extravagance of the imperial court, and especially the power of the prime minister Yang Huozhong, whose cousin sister Yang Yuhuan was the emperor's favorite concubine, and the ladies Guo and Qin were both Yang's cousin sisters. In the last few lines, the blue birds are a messenger of love, so it implies the scandal about the affair between Yang Huozhong, the prime minister, and his cousin sister Lady Guo, who also had an affair with the emperor. So this is a scorching satire on dignitaries. thanks to the open-mindedness of Tang Dynasty, both this poem and the poet could survive. And the ingenuity is that the gorgeousness was depicted seriously, without any sense of sarcasm. But in effect, it can be seen as a prediction of the upcoming turbulent time of war, which destroyed all that gorgeousness and splendor. 丽人行。三月三日天气新，长安水边多丽人。态浓意远疏且真，肌理细腻骨肉匀。绣罗衣裳照暮春，蹙金孔雀银麒麟。头上何所有？翠微烘叶垂鬓唇。背后何所见？朱鸦腰脊稳衬身。旧中云木交房亲，赐名大国国与秦。紫驼之峰出翠府，水晶之盘行素林。西金艳玉九位下，鸾刀缕切空分轮。黄门飞控不动尘，玉厨洛邑送八珍。箫鼓哀吟感鬼神，兵从杂沓食药金。后来鞍马何驱寻，当轩下马入锦阴。杨花雪落覆白屏，青鸟飞去衔红巾。炙手可热试绝伦，慎莫近前丞相嗔。The next point, I finally get a post. Service or reclusion is Du Fu's Confucian dilemma. This poem is a combination of self-mockery, relief, and irony. All of his aspirations for high office have come down to a fairly humiliating outcome. He was offered a minor job without almost any real duties. He accepts it wryly and writes this poem to commemorate the end of both his career aspirations and his dream of retiring to a hermit's life. 关定后细赠，不作何西味，凄凉未折腰。老夫怕驱走，率府且逍遥。丹酒虚微露，狂歌托圣朝。故山归兴尽，回首向风飙。
I finally get a post. Oh, good. I don't have to be police commissioner at Husay. It would have been backbreaking, supervising all those beatings. I'm an old man. I can't rush around, bustle, and strut. But the job they've given me now at Palace Guard headquarters won't take too much time. It will pay for my wine and allow me to go on writing these crazy poems. And so, no more thoughts about retirement back in the hills of home. I turn my back on that and set my face to the wind.
Part 2, The Rebellion. The Anlushan Rebellion began in December 755. And was not completely suppressed for almost 8 years. It caused enormous disruption to Chinese society. This period of unhappiness was actually the making of Du Fu as a poet. Moonlight Night. During the Anlushan Rebellion, the emperor was forced to flee the capital of Chang'an. Du Fu took his wife and children to safety at Fuzhou. Du Fu then went to join the new court, but he was intercepted by the rebels and imprisoned at Chang'an, there, he wrote this poem to his wife. 月夜, 今夜苏州月, 闺中只独堪, 遥怜小儿女, 未解忆长安, 香舞云环湿, 清辉玉璧寒, 何时已虚晃, 双照泪痕干.
Moonlight night. Tonight, in the same moonlight, my wife is alone at her window in Fuzhou. I can hardly bear to think of my children, too young to understand why I can't come to them. Her hair must be damp from the mist, her arms cold as jade in the moonlight. When will we stand together by those slack curtains while the moonlight dries the tear streaks on our faces?
Spring scene. 春望. 国破山河在. 城春草木深. 感时花溅泪. 恨别鸟惊心, 烽火连三月, 家书抵万金, 白头搔更短, 浑欲不胜簪.
Spring scene, sometimes the title of this poem is Spring in the Ruined City. The first introductory couplet might be one of the most well-known first lines in translation of Dukas' poetry. The state goes to ruin. Mountains and rivers survive. Spring in the city, thick leaves, deep grass. In times like these, the flowers seem to weep. Birds, as if they too hated separation, flutter close by, startle the heart. For 3 months, the beacon fires have been lit. A letter from home is worth a fortune. This white hair is getting sparse from scratching, almost too thin to hold a hat pin.
She thinks of him while pounding laundry. Dao Yi. 一枝树不返秋至是清真已尽苦寒月况经长别心宁辞岛韵卷一寄塞原身用尽闺中力君听空外音.
She thinks of him while pounding laundry. I have this feeling you won't come back from frontier duties, but autumn is here and I get out the laundry stove. Soon you'll feel the cold the way I feel our separation. I clean your winter clothes, whether I want to or not. Send them off to where you're stationed near the Great Wall. A woman uses all her strength beating the laundry with a club. Maybe if you listen hard, you'll hear it way out there.
An autumn storm and our thatched roof. 茅屋为秋风所破歌. 八月秋高风怒号, 卷我屋上三重茅. 毛飞渡江洒江郊, 高者挂卷长林梢, 下者飘转陈塘鳌. 南村群童欺我老无力, 忍能对面为盗贼. 公然抱毛入竹去, 唇焦口燥呼不得, 归来倚杖自叹息. 俄请封定 云墨色，秋天漠漠向昏鹤。不亲多年冷似铁，娇儿恶卧踏里裂。床头屋漏无干处，雨脚如麻未断绝。自今丧乱少睡眠，长夜沾湿何由彻。安得广厦千万间，大庇天下寒士俱欢颜。风雨不动安如山。呜呼，何时眼前突兀现此屋，吾庐独破受冻死亦足。
An autumn storm in our thatched roof, howling madly, a big September storm took off three layers of our thatched roof, spread them on the river and all along the banks, even high up and hanging among the branches of the trees, along the ground as well, in the pools and hollows. And then the boys from South Village, taking advantage of my weak old age, help themselves to thatch right in front of me, carrying off armfuls into the bamboo grove, ignoring my shouts until my voice was hoarse. I trudge back home, sighing, leaning on my stick. The wind dies down, the clouds are still quite black. They seem to reinforce the long autumn night. My threadbare quilt is cold as iron now. My little son, sleeping restlessly, has kicked it full of holes. Right above my bed, the roof is leaking. There's no dry spot. Disrupted sleep again. It's been this way ever since the rebellion. Huddled up, trying to get through this cold, soaked night, I dream of a great big house with many a million rooms, shelter for all poor people to make them smile. Even in huge rainstorms, unshakable mountain of a house, if such a house sprang up right in front of my eyes, my hut could smash, I could freeze to death, I'd still die happy.